Welcome back to another episode of the Bourbon Lens. This is Jake along with Scott, and we are going to be throwing bows on this episode of the Bourbon Lens as we are talking with Puncher's Chance. We have Umberto Luchini and Bruce Buffer here joining us from the brand. Thank you guys for joining the Bourbon Lens this afternoon.
Thank you, Scott. Appreciate it. Thank you, Jake. Nice introduction. Appreciate that too. Hi, Umberto.
Hi, Bruce. Good to see you, man.
You too, my friend.
Well, we have a big personality in Bruce and a big voice. And Umberto, for those who don't know, has a long lineage in bourbon working with other spirits brands, and he's brought this to life. And so we're excited to talk a little bit about the spirit. Going to probably talk a little bit of UFC. But just to get started, you know, how is this new brand going for you all just to get it off the ground in this crowded, booming industry that we have today?
Well, I do it from the business side, from the marketing side. I think what is exciting, it's the end product, and to keep it really top level for also for the audience. It is still an exciting category, an exciting industry. Bourbon is the traditional American spirit, and it goes to the heart of the country. It goes to the heart of what the country believes in, what the people believe in. I'm an immigrant in this place, in this country. I came 17 years ago with the belief of forging my own path. And it took a while, but in the end, I'm actually happy of what has been achieved. And this bourbon is actually a statement to support that, in that it is to support two American traditions, one fighting for what you believe in, and the second is bourbon in itself. And the name, which really opened up a door to a phenomenal collaboration with Bruce, the name is what I remembered when I was a young old teenager watching Mike Tyson lose against Buster Douglas in that memorable epic fight in Tokyo. I will never forget how just one shot can change the whole trajectory, the life actually of one person for sure. So, and I thought this was a fantastic metaphor for what we've been trying to do, what I've been trying to do since I moved to this country. And it also led the way to a phenomenal relationship, a man I met and I really got to appreciate in Bruce Buffer.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Umberto. You know, with Umberto saying that, the same stands true for me. I've wanted a spirit line to be one of the brands that I represent for the last 10 years. And I was approached by a tequila company here in the States and what they call cachaça rum out of Brazil, where the UFC and my image are, like, strangely enough, as popular as Ronaldo and everything down there. I can't even walk down the streets of Brazil without cars stopping and jumping out and taking pictures. And I thought, wow, this could be a very amazing thing if I like the product. The problem was with both instances, I didn't care for the business acumen of the people, and I always associate myself with nothing but the best, right? You know, it's the old story, if you lie with pigs, you smell like, right? Mm-hmm. I wanted to lie with the best. So I had a chance to meet Umberto and our other partner, Brad Leviton. And again, with those other products, the other thing was the products I didn't enjoy. And I will not represent a product if I can't be a product of the products, which means that I enjoy using it. You know, I have too many choices that come at me. I turn down a lot of deals almost weekly that want to use my image or whatever. But again, it's about quality and what fits my brand and my mission statement for my brand and my future. When I met Umberto and Brad, we immediately clicked with our passion. Mm. It was obvious they were so passionate about this project. And bourbon's my favorite spirit to drink. So it was a win-win walking in the door. And then when they showed me the name of the product, Puncher's Chance, like Umberto said, the whole concept of the underdog just hit me right away. You know, Buster Douglas was a 32-1 underdog the night he stepped in the ring with Mike Tyson. And the biggest regret I have is that I didn't put $10,000 on him because I wanted to. But anyway, that's another story. So in my life, I've been an underdog, as all of us have, in everything we've gone into or many things we've gone into. And as an example for me, when I was 28, I met a man that I saw on TV that would come out, you know, looking like James Bond and say, let's get ready to rumble, when boxing was jamming and just the biggest thing in the water cooler conversation on Monday, the way the UFC is today. And it turned out to be my long lost half brother, Michael Buffer. I never even knew he existed. I had two companies. I was making tremendous money, beach house, living the 2.5 men lifestyle minus the alcoholism and just enjoying life. But I was burned out on what I was doing. I wasn't happy. I had no passion for what I was doing. And I rolled the dice to take over his management, become his partner and his manager. And we turned that into a $500 million brand over the years. I did the same thing with the UFC, giving up a lot to become their announcer in the early days when I was making a little bit of money and losing money on trust. But I loved it so much because I've been a martial artist my whole life. And I fought, never as a professional, but I fought more than I can remember. And that really drew me in too passionately. Now that company sold for $4.2 billion, the largest price ever paid for a franchise. And I take great pride in having done my part beyond being the Octagon announcer to build that brand with my media contacts and what I could do for them. Immediately when I had this conversation and then I tasted the sweet nectar of the bourbon gods, as I call it. I mean, it's amazing. It's an amazing liquid. It's an amazing spirit. They're amazing partners to work with. Umberto, with his, when I realized his marketing background with Campari, you know, and Brad's involvement with Cabo Wabo Tequila and the Skinny Girl, you know, brand and everything else, it's like, wow, this is a match made in heaven. This is what I've been looking for. This is the moment I've been waiting for. And that's exactly why I jumped into the mix. I'm not a fan of the word celebrity. I don't like even saying that about myself. I consider myself equal to everybody. Do not try to fight me and do not try to announce against me. You'll have a problem. Okay. So the bottom line is I work with them as a partner. I just didn't go into a studio and take pictures for 2 days that could be used at point of purchase advertising. They're incredible individuals. I love Umberto. I love Brad. We get along great. And you know what? The formula is working. We've been at this now for almost 2 years. And I would consider with the 6 gold medals that we've won, 3 for taste and 3 for design of the bottle. Thank you, Umberto. You're so brilliant. And also the Bourbon Spectator just called us one of the top 5 best sipping bourbons in the $30 price range. So as the English say during World War II, everything's going according to schedule. You know, it's a great business. I love it. Yeah. It's awesome. I want to show Conor McGregor how to do it the proper way. So we're all good.
Oh, that was great because one of the guys who is normally on the podcast is a big UFC fan, and he loves Conor McGregor. So he would have like
well, we'll have
out
a talk
chair
to him about his opinion of good people in the world, but that's okay.
Yeah, so that leans to this idea, right, of Mike Tyson, Buster Douglas, and this opportunity to be the underdog in this crowded category, right? So when you come up with your formulary of whiskey to bring out, right, you know, of the main brands, the Heaven Hills, the Wild Turkeys, Buffalo Trace, whomever, how do you start to position yourself amongst those titans to give yourself that one shot to knock a consumer off their feet and for them to go pick up Puncher's Chance time and time again?
Sure. Well, I'll start speaking about the brand and then if you want, we can talk about the liquid. Both obviously are integral in finding your own space. But as a real key premise is that in spirits, packaging and branding is very important. It's I have to say it's nearly 2/3 of the cost of the final product. I don't say it's like perfume where nearly 90% is packaging and the rest is just a synthetic formula. But in spirits, packaging and branding is very, very important. If you take wine, you choose your wine and then maybe you look for a brand. But in spirits, it's really branding. So starting with that, I worked for many years on an iconic bourbon brand, which allowed me also to discover the world of Kentucky, the world outside Louisville and Lexington, which is a whole different Kentucky. And if you remember the series Justified, I mean, that really gave it the right perspective. Phenomenal state, a state that has, it's a commonwealth, that has an incredible history, but the people and the culture is what really got me in. And throughout those years working on these brands, I got to see their strength. I got to appreciate their power, their history, their culture, and heritage. So the story of the underdog is also the story of being honest and transparent. We don't have that history. I'm from Italy. I can sell you grappa and Italian wine. But so for us, it was really crucial being transparent. And the only way, the only element I saw that we could stand out, we do have a master distiller that has history. But, you know, when you work with Jimmy Russell, everybody else is kind of a young kid in town. Mm-hmm. And so I couldn't really leverage that part. I don't have a distillery that has two centuries of history, who has gone through prohibition. I don't have all those elements. So the only thing I could tap into is exactly the fact that bourbon is a core American product and that the people behind it are honest people who are trying to forge their own path within this big, big category, offering high quality liquid at affordable price and an outstanding packaging. Those three are for me the elements that can allow me to stand out in the spirits world in a crowded category. Obviously, execution then is crucial. That's where Brad Levitt and the team comes in place in getting that distribution. There are some phenomenal brands out there, but they may not have the scale or the financial resources to scale at a national level. We have that. And so the way was basically the white space was identified by seeing that all the brands out there really leverage their core strengths, which are phenomenal. Their distillers, their history, the name of the founder. I mean, we look at a shelf and there's a story behind all of them. However, they all gravitate around one territory, which is really about core America. So, and heritage. And I went a bit the other direction in saying, okay, I can't tap into that, but there's another element of America that is very, very important. And that is the chance of doing it, of making it, of having success. The American dream, as much as is being a lot, not very well respected right now, believe me, there's a lot of people still in the line trying to get in this country because they believe in that. And that I wanted, I think was an element worthwhile to communicate through a bourbon. In terms of liquid, we wanted to be sure we could partner with somebody who had Kentucky straight bourbon. There's a lot of bourbon out there, a lot of great bourbon out there, but it's hard to find Kentucky straight bourbon. And that's because, to your point, big brands, big companies, they are now holding very tight their inventories. The market is growing. So it's a very valuable product. And as you know, as it ages, it increases in value. So for us, through our partnership with IJW Whiskey, which has been buying bourbon for the last 5 years under the radar, we actually struck gold because we found excellent quality bourbon. Also niche products that we can launch as limited editions. And at the same time, have enough volume to be present in 50 states and growing as we are growing. We are at the $30 price point. We are the fastest growing bourbon. So we and very small structure that started 2 years ago. And let's not forget what has happened in the last 2 years as well.
Well, I think that's really interesting that you're saying like $30 price point. A lot of people don't realize when these brands enter into the market, they're putting out $75, $85, $95 price point. And to the average consumer who is picking up, a Heaven Hill bottled and bond product for $15.99 their entire life, it's going to be hard for them to elevate into that high space, even if they, maybe associate Bruce or maybe, understand your background, Umberto. Like, they may be hard for them to reach at $85, but at $30, that's an easier reach for them to go and grab that. And so I think that's a really nice way to fit in the American dream because you're going to give them a chance to go get that where they typically may not go and buy that $85 new brand. And you do have an elevated one. We'll talk about the distance in a little bit, but for that regular offering, $30 is super reasonable.
Well, one of the key things here, and I have to credit Umberto and Brad for making this decision, we could have easily sold the initial Puncher's Chance brand that's out there for the $30 price range for over $60 a bottle because the liquid is actually that quality, okay? But that price point, everything we're talking about here, we wanted to make sure that we were able to get it in the hands of middle America and all the demographics around it. The 75% of fans of the UFC are males 21 to 34. They're on the average not really able to afford or, in the price range, $120 bottle or an $80 bottle. But the beautiful thing that Brad and Umberto and we're doing here at Wolf Spirits is that we're giving them the $30 bottle, which is kind of opening up the bourbon pipeline to Puncher's Chance. Whereas we do release, which we're going to talk about the distance, which is 120 plus a bottle that sold out within a week with our whole supply. Right. So it's about supply and demand. And the key thing in any business in the world and every business I've been involved in is marketing. If you have a piece of coal and you market it correctly, people perceive it as a diamond. If you have a diamond and you don't market it correctly, it looks like a piece of coal. We have a diamond and we have incredible marketers like Umberto. And, you know, as a team, we're just knocking it down. Mm. It's very smart thinking. This is the other reason I'm involved in this company. I'm very particular. Again, I only work with the best. Their 3-year plan for this is amazing. And again, it's all going according to schedule.
No, that, I think that's awesome. And, you know, when you think about liquid, right, and, you know, juice, whatever you want to call it, I'm typical just to call it the spirit.
Buff juice.
Buff juice. There we go. It's time to go get you some buff juice. There's your next punchline.
It's buff juice time.
There we go. I'm with it. I'm with it. When you went for that profile, what profile did you think would stand out to that consumer that would want to buy this liquid or keep going back to it?
Yeah, very, very good question. I obviously, being bourbon, you have a dominance of corn, which makes it sweet. And compared to single malt, scotches, Japanese even, in general, a good whiskey drinker will always tell you, yeah, bourbon is always towards the sweetness. And then you have the leverage of proof and the fact that being in Kentucky with the weather conditions and the way they are stored, you can't really push the aging as far as with single malts and scotches. So what I asked, because I'm not a distiller or a blender, was to obviously maintain that corn level to a sweetness point that makes it distinctively bourbon. So within the whiskey world, we are a bourbon. Nobody's going to say, well, it's more rye or things like that. What I wanted to do is give a bit of a kick. So get a proof level that was below 100, so between 85 and 95. And then I let the blenders honestly do the work. I know what it is to market a bourbon above 100 proof, and it just becomes very challenging, a big challenge to make it a national and sessionable, as you say, drink more than once. And I do think that a bit of the kick really helps in highlighting some of the spiciness that rye brings. And so I found a good balance between 75% corn. And then the predominant is rye after that with 90 proof, allowing the spiciness to kick in towards the end as you sip. This really is for one reason. Although I always say that, like Jimmy Russell used to say, put a few ice cubes in a glass, throw them away and pour my bourbon. That's the best way to drink bourbon, true. But if you mix it, old fashioned, a bourbon mule, now the Kentucky mule is becoming very popular also because something's happening in Moscow, which is not helping. So, but it's helping us. It, because of the spiciness, it kicks in. And so when you drink it in a cocktail, which is what the majority of people do, especially a $30 product, they will definitely feel the power of the product without feeling like they had a knock on the head. Mm.
I personally learned how to make a great old fashioned. So a girlfriend of mine who's a bartender for many years came over. I got my lesson and I consider myself almost an expert, Umberto. I know how to do it all.
Oh yeah.
Nice thing.
Yeah. The bitters. Yeah.
It mixes. It mixes fantastic, guys. I mean, I have my own energy product coming out that I'm already working on formulas for. And when I mix it with my energy product, my drink, it tastes great. It's amazing how well this mixes, you know, and that's a very key factor. Because like Umberto said, not everybody drinks it straight. I drink my bourbon straight, right? But people love to mix and this thing, perfect.
Yeah, I think it's got a lot of flavor to it. I was just over here like nosing and tasting, and I think it's got a lot of flavor. And kudos to you, Bruce, on the product placement. No one else is going to see this but me and you and Scott and Umberto, but I see your product placement back there. You're doing a good job.
It's my podcast area.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's an open bottle, by the way.
Oh yeah, this well, we'll talk about it, but this has definitely gone a little bit of a distance.
There we go, Scott. What do you think? What's your impressions? I know you're a big corn guy. Scott loves corn bourbon.
Yeah, this one definitely speaks to me, and you know that, Jake. But 75% corn, I'm all about it. That's what Kentucky bourbon is to me. High corn hits you with the sweetness. Little bit of heat, but I think it's I don't think it's the proof. I think it's the rye spice, like what you're talking about. Yeah, but at 90 proof. Ultra drinkable. I will admit to this bottle probably has been in my glass several times leading up to this episode. So it's right up my alley. And I think that, you know, for $30-$35, it's hard to go wrong.
Well, it's hard to go wrong with the viscosity on this. My favorite thing about it is the mouthfeel on it's phenomenal. It literally coats your entire palate from front to back. And that's why I think it would hold up well in an old fashioned, because the components aren't going to dilute as you've done that. So this bourbon has really good structure to it. Because you do get a little oaky influence and oaky note on the back end. Yes, yeah. That's a typical note, but not every bourbon gives you oak, right? This one has a nice lingering oak in the nose and to the palate, but the structure of the distillate itself carries through, and it's very coating. And that's what you don't necessarily find in this price point is viscosity and that mouthfeel. And so that's where I would say this stands out to me personally, because it does hit on that corn sweetness that you mentioned, but the viscosity on it is kudos. Chef's kiss.
Thank you. I'm very big on aftertaste. I love enjoying, you know, slowly sipping my bourbon, but the aftertaste feel of it, it's just this, that's one thing that really hit me, is the lingering, wonderful aftertaste of this bourbon. I love that.
Yeah. So, you know, you got to have your plan, right? Bruce is talking about your 3-year plan and your path forward. And so you've partnered with of what a lot of people didn't know about IJW at all, right? All of a sudden it popped up and they're like, oh yeah, we have a ton of barrels and we're still going to have a ton of barrels and you don't know anything about us. Great. But they've started to produce, you know, partnerships like yourself. And so now you're talking about extending your shelf life and going the distance in this brand per se. You know, what made you lean into this 12-year-old bourbon? I've not drank it yet, so this is all new to me when I sip it here in a second. You know, what made you lean into 12-year or going that longer age? Did it have to do with the whole boxing ideology there? Because it does fit, right? But I just want to talk about that.
Yeah, of course. So the if I wanted to be smart, I would say, yeah, that all this was planned. The reality, like most successful things, they happen by either chance or mistake. This wasn't a mistake, but definitely by chance. The number one rule of a marketer is know what you don't know, because that will allow you to avoid messing things up. And I am not a distiller. I'm not a blender. What I asked is find among your treasures something that has a good age between 8 and 14. That's what my experience taught me, is in general, you have a very good selection of bourbon. And then add a twist to it. That twist is, you guys are the expert. And we invested in getting the best blenders out there. Kevin Curtis has worked for Angel's Envy, and as well as Woodford Reserve. And you know how Angel's Envy has created its reputation because of its finishes. Mm-hmm. And that for me was an asset. So I thought, give me an age between 8 and 14. That was my brief. Find me a liquid 8 and 14 years old that we can finish with something that is, that makes it really unique and distinctive and can hold a premium price. As Bruce said, we are talking about 120 and above and limited quantities. And every year I want to do something similar, not the same, because I am not going to play the game in that sense. But, and then depending on the liquid, that's the marketer's job. Get creative in marketing it. And honestly, originally, and this is, I don't know if Bruce remembers, but the first liquid was actually a 13-year-old that they proposed. And I tasted it and I felt it, I felt it was a bit too strong. And I wasn't, because already we are higher in proof. We are around 96. So I felt like, is there something younger? And they just said, we just have a 12-year-old, a bit more liquid. And then it became, 12 is even perfect, because 12 is the rounds, it's the distance, and the connection with boxing really happened by chance in that sense. But believe me, I have a list of 10 other names that are ready to be launched depending on what liquid, and I already know what's the next for this year, the next variant to the distance, but that stays with me right now. But it's going to be another phenomenally good liquid, aged again, with another finishing that is going to be incredibly surprising, because there's really one or two only in the bourbon category of these finishes. And then the branding, we'll let consumers judge.
Well, now color me intrigued for the next podcast episode later down the line when that releases.
Nothing more exciting than the impending event, my friends.
Oh, well, and you know that, right? As leading up to whatever UFC, like 550, because they're ever ending numbers, and I can't keep up with them. I know they're in the 200s, I believe. So when you're seeing this, Bruce, right, you're talking about this evolution and this 3-year plan, and you get to see what that premium product looks like. What's your thought about like helping them elevate, you know, with your connections, right? Because you are a connected individual. We won't call you celebrity because we talked about that earlier and I don't want to fight you. But you know, we're talking about elevation, right? How do you elevate their great marketing with your ability to bring in people and fans from across the world?
You know, my job in life, I never thought I'd become a cheerleader, and I became the ultimate cheerleader, you know, as I like to joke about. And for me, whatever I'm involved in, aside from the greatness of the event, such as a UFC, or the greatness of an amazing product, such as Puncher's Chance Bourbon, you bring me into the room to enhance the moment. So I need to take it to the next level. So if I'm announcing a fighter, I need to bring him up. If I'm representing my beautiful sweet nectar of the bourbon gods, as I call it, Puncher's Chance Bourbon, then I need to apply that same principle to that. So the product speaks for itself. It's an amazing thing to represent a product that sells itself. Mm. I've gone into retail stores in my home area, put the bottle on the table, not even say who I am, where they recognize who I am, and the bottle sells itself, and they taste it and they're sold. Mm. It's rare that you have a product like that that sells itself, as I like to say. So my job is made a little easier that way, but I need to create the atmosphere and the grandiose image of it, which is not a lie. It's really not an embellishment. It's telling it the way it is. So I'm coming out to open up that Oscar award ceremony, that Broadway show. Everything you see in life, whether you open up a book or you watch a movie or you watch a stage play or a TV show, it's got to hit you in that first couple minutes to keep you watching the entire show, to make you want to taste it. That's my job, right? My job is more than that, but that's how I look at it is. So I need to come in and honestly promote this product for the beautiful product that it is with my announcing abilities and my IP, my image, and my It's Time brand, which again, I don't give that to everybody, right? I don't give that to everybody. And if I've associated myself with you, I consider that a gift to you as well as I consider a gift to me that I get to work with you. So I'm in nirvana. I'm doing what I love.
No, that I think that that's awesome. And, you know, we're not taking it for granted that you're spending time with us today on an afternoon talking about, you know, this whiskey. And to getting into that, right? The elevation, I think we talked a little, you talked about the bottle, but a lot of people can't see it, and we're going to showcase it throughout the week when this podcast drops. But talk a little bit, how did you get to that blacked out label to really stand out in a crowd?
I looked at 99% of the bars and phenomenal brands out there, great high-end whiskeys, bourbons, and the majority clear bottles, clear labels. Why? Number one reason, logical, the liquid is beautiful to look at. So legitimate why the majority do that. The problem is the more you drink of it, the more it disappears on the back bar. Now, if you're a major brand that sells 9 million cases, yeah, people will know you. But when you're new, and if half of the liquid goes, or half of the branding disappears because people are drinking it, it doesn't really help standing out. And then I obviously, this is in bar environments where it's already kind of dark. In retail, you have a bit of everything, and so the light doesn't really help in getting a lot of the effects. So I thought that let's go a different color. Let's go black and portray strength and intrigue in the category, because black is a color for strength, and it's always perceived as premium and luxury. If you look at most of the luxury brands in general, they do leverage black and gold quite a lot. There's a reason to it. That's how the eye operates. But at the same time, I wanted to show the liquid and to give a sense of those nectars of the gods that Bruce refers to. And so it kind of fades, the black fades towards the bottom, allowing one to understand when the bottle is finished. So there's not the complaining. I don't know if there's still liquid in it. You see it. And two, you actually get to appreciate it. Has a phenomenal effect in the bar environment because it brings that brown gold caramel look into it. But at the same time, it stands out because it's white on black. I mean, the logo is white and black. I mean, there's a reason why black and white, they work well together. And then I added the tiger because also, and I was comforted by Bruce on that. It is the understated symbol within MMA and in general, that community internationally. I looked at Asia, I looked at South America. The majority of tattoos that these phenomenal fighters have an animal, which is a tiger, a lion, a leopard, a jaguar, a version of it. And the beauty of the tiger, for me, it's just, this year, by the way, is the year of the tiger, which also helps. the beauty of the tiger is that it is an animal of incredible presence, strength, fascination, and respect. And it really fits very well with this community, which is our number one target, which takes me to the point that you really have to focus on your first 1,000 believers to get a brand off starting to grow. Then it will be adopted by the general marketplace. But any brand out there from one in any category always started by 1,000. I say 1,000 to give you a dimension, but 1,000 people who just fell in love with it and adopted it as their brand. And then it starts to become obviously bigger and bigger.
You know, the other thing about the tiger, it's a Muay Thai tiger. It's amazing that this is the year, you know, of the tiger and all. Maybe that's a poetic situation for us. But even going back to like Rocky II when he bought the black jacket, if you remember, that's the Muay Thai tiger on the back of the jacket. It's so synonymous with the fighting world internationally and every form of fighting, from boxing to martial arts.
Mm. Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And, you know, thinking about, you know, bringing this into your world a little bit, as you know, have this spirit that you all are representing, a lot of news negative recently in the UFC, just by people having some issues, Masvidal, Connor, as we talked about briefly. You know, where is the future of that sport going from an MMA perspective? And like, what should we be paying attention to as we're paying attention to this drink, this elevated drink here? What should we be paying attention to in the UFC or the mixed martial arts world in the next, you know, year or so?
You know, if you put 10 men in a room, there's always going to be two a-holes, okay? there's always going to be somebody that's going to ruffle up the bunch, all right? Yeah. You read about Jorge Masvidal being arrested for, you know, basically what honestly looks like assault.
Yeah.
You know, he's a street kid. Colby's not a street kid. Colby's an amazing fighter and warrior, but he's a sport warrior. Not saying he wouldn't take you out on the street, but it's that's not what he's there for. Masvidal is a backyard brawler, street fighter. I like them both. They're both very cool cats. But in the sports world, look at every single sport out there. There's always somebody that's going to do something. Conor McGregor just gets arrested for speeding in Dublin. And God knows we've witnessed a number of ridiculously horrific assaults, you know, a couple in particular that he's done. So he's gone on to make his hundreds of millions, yet he's gotten bad press, right? There's always somebody's going to be like that. Put that aside and look at the fact that the UFC has well over 500 fighters on its roster. They're all the top A-list fighters in the sport of mixed martial arts. The UFC is the rocket ship leading the way for everything else. And it's the biggest fighting event in the world. Mm. Again, this thing sold for $4.2 billion, the most ever paid for a sports franchise. The future, focus on the beauty of these highly skilled, or as Charles Barkley once told me, the most highly conditioned athletes in the world. Their dedication to the sport, it takes years to get to this level. There's always going to be a black marble in the sea of pearls, okay? It happens. So you have to work past it. Jorge gets arrested, Conor goes through his thing. These are human issues that are happening outside what the UFC is all about.
Yeah.
We are martial artists. We are about honor, blood, sweat, and tears. There are going to be occasionally an individual that's going to go against that. But like I said on TMZ, when Conor attacked the bus in New York, I said he shite all over us in my 25 years of work in one move. But that is not who we are. Mm. Okay. So look at the beauty of the UFC. Look at the beauty of these warriors. Watch the UFC on Saturday. We just came back from London, selling out the O2 Arena, over 20,000 people. Dana White normally gives three bonuses a night, 50,000 each to the fighters. They put their blood, sweat, and tears in the Octagon floor. He gave out nine $50,000 bonuses last Saturday night to young fighters making maybe 10, 20,000 for their fight. This changes their world.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we're providing the most amazing, highest level of fighting ability in the mixed martial arts that the world can see.
Yeah.
And that's who we are. This is an A-list product. And occasionally you have a few black marbles that can trickle out. I can say that about baseball, football. Look what happened to the Raiders in Vegas, who I represent and open every home game for them.
Yeah.
Right. Look at the things that happened this season. Maybe people say, well, they shouldn't have gone to Vegas. These young guys get whatever. No, you're either with it, on top of it, a good guy or a bad guy. You don't speed and kill a kid in the car unless you're an idiot.
Mm-hmm.
That's on the individual. That's not on the sport of the UFC or the sport of the NFL. Yeah. So you got to separate the two.
Yeah. No, I think
there's some bad podcaster hosts out there too, buddy.
Trust me. Don't get me started.
We'll keep our nose clean over here on the bourbon lens.
Yeah.
You look like it's all good.
So, Bruce, I got to know, whenever you were first announcing, I think it was in the mid 90s, the UFC, and I was 10 years old at the time.
Thank you for that. I feel very old. It's okay.
Yeah.
And I remember begging my dad to let me watch UFC back when it was becoming a thing. Because I was a WWF fan at the time. Did you ever think that when you were announcing these fights, that that's where this sport would have transitioned to? And 25 years later, that this is where we would be. I mean, that's kind of something that's been in my head this whole time.
Well, my biography was released by Random House about 9 years ago. And I specifically stated in it that yes, from the very first moment, I realized back then that it was a spectacle, right? It needed to be refined. When I first saw it, a lot of people couldn't handle it because there was so much brutality going on. I mean, back then it was like, it was like blood sport. What's the best style, right? Tank Abbott coming off a bar stool to fighting a hugely eighth black degree down black belt in Taekwondo or something. And then about 7 years in, it became mixed martial arts. But I knew from the very beginning, this could be the biggest thing happening in sports. That's why I got my brother involved in the first three events before I took over the announcing. I had to pull him because of his contract with the WCW. He never would have been able to continue. And they were upset that he was doing the UFC. That's a whole nother story. Then I got involved in it and I worked for short money. I would lose money on these trips, you know, compared to what I was doing in my other business life. But I stuck with it because I knew it was going to be the biggest thing. From day one, I knew it. And then when the Fertitta brothers and Dana White bought it in 1999, roughly, I had dinner with them and I realized Umberto and Brad, our other partner, the passion they had for the sport. And I knew we were on our way. This is what was going to make it work. And lo and behold, that's exactly what happened. So there's a thing in life that, like I said earlier, I've been an underdog and gone after things that people said, don't even go there. You're not going to make it. If you're going to believe in something, you stick with it. If you marry somebody and say forever, you stick with it. Otherwise you wind up getting divorced. I've never been married. I've almost been divorced twice. I'll be 65 in May. And I don't plan on ever getting divorced in my life. If I get married, it's going to be walking down the aisle, love forever. I sign an agreement with Umberto because I want to walk the bourbon love forever with my partners. And it's all working.
Well, I think that is something America needs a lot more of.
I love to motivate people. I love giving, you know, I love working with people. I do motivational speeches, helping people build their brands or break down their companies. And I've had so many companies I've owned. My first one since I was 19. I'm just not an announcer. That's my weekend Boy Scouts go to camp job. You know, I run about 8 or 10 different businesses during the week. So I know business.
Yeah.
And I know brilliant people and I know quality people to work with. And again, for the umpteenth time, that's why I am with Umberto.
Yeah.
That's why I'm here.
And I think that matters, right? We were doing a podcast earlier this week with another large brand, but that's still small comparative. And one of the things that I was very appreciative of, and I'm appreciative of this podcast, is because I can tell the passion, right? So many times people have the company line and they tow it and that's it. But you all are passionate about what you all are doing as a group, right? The three of you all.
Thank you. Let's go team. Go team.
Yeah. It's all about the team, right? And so that's what I'm sitting over here like the whiskey's good. Like it's really good whiskey. But the partnership and the passion behind it makes it all the much more. And that's why we're excited about doing these different things like in the podcast, is because we get to tell that story along with you all and share in that experience. And that gets me excited to pour another, you know, glass of Puncher's Chance.
Pour another, my friend. And you know, the big thing about passion is, and this relates to everybody out there, when you wake up in the morning and you've got a job to go do, if you're passionate about it, it becomes a lifestyle. So you're not going to work, you're living your life. Okay. And in business, if you're not passionate, no matter what your business is, I don't care if you're a waiter, an actor, or you own a business, whatever, whatever you're doing, your endeavor, when you get knocked down and hit the canvas, right, with passion, you're able to get up, like Rocky said, and move forward and punch harder than ever. And that's what it takes to win the game. If you don't have passion, you're going to stay on that canvas and go find another ring to play in. Well, I don't like switching jobs, man. If I get into something, I'm dedicated.
Yeah. No, I hear you there loud and clear.
Rhymed. That was cool.
I'm not going to quit my day job to be a full-time podcast announcer. Umberto, I have to know, like, as you think about this, these next things, right, that you may be doing, right? You have this special release in the distance. You know, what does the next, you know, 6 to 12 months look like for Puncher's Chance? Will we see that distance round two, you know, come out in 2022, or is that a 23 project?
Let's call it the distance number two is going to be a 2022 project. The liquid is available. I'm finalizing the packaging. I need to get Bruce's big smile once he sees it. I've been lucky. He's been smiling all the time I showed him stuff. So once all that will be released between July and August for Bourbon Month in September. And then we are a bit earlier. We're actually coming out with a single barrel, which is going to be a permanent product. So a standard single barrel, we are looking at 108 proof. So 54%, and that is a classic Kentucky single barrel. That is a phenomenal packaging again, but it's like single barrels. It's a sipping bourbon, and that will be released around May, June, trying to hit Father's Day. So one thing, and you hear me being a bit uncertain on the timing, there's two things. There's a global situation which is not helping. And not just the supply chain issues we've been hearing for a year or so, but a lot of the glass around the world is produced in Ukraine and Poland, and you know what's happening there. So it's a bit tight, but we should be able to hit this date. And then honestly, the success of a small operation, of a startup, is in focusing, being very focused. And we are moving 1 year at a time. We have 3 year plans. We even have 5 year plans for certain brands just because of the investments behind it. But it all happens today and tomorrow. So we this year we are growing more than we had produced for and budgeted for, which is a good problem to have, but it's still a problem. And we hopefully we should be doubling our volume this year. And with the introduction of two new products, it's going to also increase our financial ability to do more stuff next year. And have, honestly, you hear it also from Bruce, it's not about the destination for us. It's really enjoying the journey. Mm. We are all doing it because we really enjoy it. We are lucky enough that we don't need a 9-to-5 job. We can choose a bit, and we chose to create brands and have fun along the way.
You know, this is a true test of me holding a secret, because the single barrel version coming out, I know the name and it's incredible. And Umberto, you're so good at keeping a secret. I want to say the name so bad, but I'm not going to.
No. Yeah, did a good job there.
soon enough. We'll get a press release from Dave, and we'll make a big to-do about it when that happens. You know, in the essence of time, you know, one of the things that we like to do is allow brands to tell our followers, you know, where they can find out more about Puncher's Chance. So if they want to go buy this product, where could they find it or learn more about it?
Well, website is puncherschancebourbon.com. And I encourage that, because basically from there, you can access everywhere. Even you can buy product directly. Actually, the distance is featured because still for a limited time, we're making it available online. Retailers have pretty much grabbed everything away from us. But website for sure. We have Instagram. We are present on Facebook and Twitter as well. But the website is kind of the gateway to the world of Puncher's Chance. And then tune in and listen to Bruce, because his YouTube channel is phenomenal. And honestly, he's just the right person in this moment in life where we need somebody to cheer us up.
Yeah.
Thank you, Umberto. Yeah, follow me on Instagram at Bruce Buffer UFC, and I'm always posting things. But go to puncherschancebourbon.com because, again, it's so easy to buy a bottle online, have it shipped out, and the retail outlets all across the country, everywhere, that are taking us from Costco to BevMo to Albertsons to all the Winn-Dixie stores in Florida, which are ordering like 20, 30 cases, you know, per order. They're selling so well. And when there's a UFC pay-per-view, I mean, I'm told the rush on the stores for Puncher's Chance, you know, to have a drink during a UFC by the fans is really big. But there's just so many outlets. But again, go to puncherschancebourbon.com. That's the best advice I can give. All the information's there. And if it's not at your local store, although it will be soon, just order online, you know, just grab one. Have it delivered right to the door, just like we're all doing, you know, Amazon it, baby.
Soon enough, right? Soon enough, you'll be able to get your Puncher's Chance on Amazon. Not yet.
I was using that as a term.
I know, but trust me, they bought Whole Foods for a reason. It wasn't for food. Yeah. So, guys, we are immensely appreciative of the opportunity to get to talk to you all. When Scott brought this to me, I was like, sure, like, I watch enough UFC to be dangerous, and I like whiskey, so let's go. And I just really want to say thank you for the opportunity to sit down and interview you all. As always, thanks for our listeners for listening to this episode of The Bourbon Lens. Please like, rate us, give us a 5-star review on your favorite podcast listening app. You can also find out more about our journey on social medias, on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok at Bourbon Lens. And lastly, if you want exclusive access to Bourbon Lens information, go over to patreon.com/bourbonlens and sign up to get exclusive access to things like our single barrels and the tasting experiences. And until next time, cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you so much. Cheers, everybody.